Good morning, afternoon, good evening. Come to webdocument on coolchat.com. If you are accessing this video on YouTube, CoolChat is an educational resource portal where programming courses have been taught and other courses as well. So the course content can be found on coolchat.com. So if you're on youtube.com, you can visit CoolChat to get the course content of what I'll be teaching today. So if this is your first time, my name is Godwin, and today we are on week 4 of our web development. So we are on the site, get the course on under courses, information technology, then you choose web development. You can as well get the course on the front page. Okay, now I'll zoom the page so that the text can be huge so that you can see them clearly. If you visited the site, the way it looks. Now, if you have to contact me, you need to log in your CoolChat account. If you don't have an account, you create one. So when you log in, you will see chat with an instructor. So in the chat with an instructor, you can just send a message. So if you log in, there will be chat with an instructor over here. So you just click and send me a message. If you have a programming error in the content of what I'm teaching, you can just take a snapshot and send me in the chat so I can reply you and figure out what you might need. But this is week 4. We are starting object-oriented programming. So we are going to learn classes. Then we learn about inheritance. Then we see the difference between public and private. Then we see how you can create objects. You see how you can have class variables. Then we have the constructors of the class. Then we briefly talk about two special methods that you need to know about, which we were already discussing under the constructors. Okay, so what is a class? So why do we need a class? Now in object-oriented programming, we create a class so that when we need the same methods, we just rewrite the code again. So we just create an object or copy and we can use the methods which we've written already. So object-oriented programmers are normally referred to as reusability of code, because you can write a code once and you can use it as many as you want by just creating objects of that class. And functions in the class are referred to as a method. So in your previous week, we learned about functions. So it's the same knowledge in the class. So a function in the class is just referred to as a method. You know, a function begins with a keyword function and has a name, which also follows the naming rules as well. Then a function may have a parameter in the input, which is passed. A function will also return a value. So the same thing with the methods, just a function in the class. Okay. Now, to write a class, you need to start with the keyword class. Then you need to give it the class a name. So you write a name. Normally, classes in almost all the programming languages begins with the first letter begins with a capital letter. So even though you can choose your own name, ideally, you're supposed to start the classes with capital letter. The first letter, capital letter. So you give the class a name based on what you are doing. And as I advise you, your naming should reflect to what you are doing. So if you are writing a class for students, it can be a student with S, capital S. Then if you are writing a class for a person, then it can be person with capital P. And so on, as you see in the subsequent lesson. So this is a skeleton of a class. A class has a name. Then a class, most classes have variables. Variables can be public, private, or protected based on how you want to encapsulate your class or your variable. Now a class will also have a constructor. or may or may not have. If you don't include any constructor in your class, a default constructor will be created for you with empty inputs. Okay. But if you decide to initialize your variables using constructors, then you can write your own constructor. So a constructor is also a function. So and it's supposed to be public so that it can be accessed all the objects where you'll be creating the object of that class. So you just write public, then function, then this is two underscore. So you have two underscore, then construct. Okay. Then you have your input values where you use to initialize your class variables. Okay. Now if your class variable name is the same as your input variable names, then you differentiate that of the class and that of the constructor input value with the this keyword. So this dash greater than is will be and the variable name will be referring to the variable name of the class, and the other one will be referring to the variable name of the input. But if they are different variable names, they don't need a this. Get the variable name is equal to that of the variable name of the input to initialize your class variables. Then the class may have a function or method, so you write a list of functions you need for the class. So, like I advise you, even though you can create your own name the way you want it, it's advisable that your name start with a capital, the first letter start with a capital letter. Okay. So, this example where we'll be writing a class for students. So, in a class for students, we have these variable names. Okay. In this example, I'm using just three variables name, but you can add more variables like phone, address, etc. Okay, so this we have the teaching hours is limited, so I'm supposed to give you it. So then you, the one who are learning, you can add more things to it so that you can be practicing more and master the code. So you first of all declare your variables over here, and if you decide to use a constructor to initialize your variable, then I start the constructor in public. Function, then two underscore, then construct, then the input of your constructor input. So the constructor input is basically the input you use to initialize your class variables. Okay. So if your class, so this fn is the first name, which is the variable for the student class, and this one will be used to initialize that one. So we take note that this, in this case, the first name and the fn variable names are different. Okay. Now for this one, the inputs for the last name, the name is $ln, the variable name, and this one is also ln. Okay. So to differentiate between this one and this, you need to qualify this with the this keyword. Then this one to the name for the student ID the same as this. So if you are assigning the value, you need to qualify that of the class name by using this. So for this one, because this and the one over there, the fn are different, you can just pass it over there. But for the ln and the ln, which is for the class, and the ln for the constructor, since they are the same, you need to differentiate that of the class using dollar this, then dash greater than, then the variable name over here is equal to in the input, which is the constructor input over here. The same with the student ID. It comes for them. So for example, this is a method called greet. Okay. So this one says welcome to advanced web programming and the name of the student. So here we have this fn. Okay. So that's this fn. So this so to get the name first name and the name of the last name, which was used to initialize during the when the object is created. You see how you create objects. Now, if you want to update the values, you also use set methods. So set methods takes in the value you want to set the variable, then it will assign that value to the class variable to update what you have in the constructor. Then in some classes too, one may decide to use the set method to set all the class variables. So if the person decides not to use a constructor, so we just call set first name to, or set fn to set the first name, we call set ln to set the last name, set student ID to set the student ID instead of using a constructor. So you the programmer, you decide. But sometimes so you may have a constructor, but you need a set method to update your previously written values which you've assigned on the memory using a constructor. Okay, so the set methods are also important. If it's necessary for you to use, you can write it as well. Okay, then we have the so each of them have their set and the get methods. So the set will assign, we assign a value to the class variable, then the get will return the value which has been set. So we are going to start our example. So we write an example code for our students. So in our example, we'll start our example. Then I'm going to create a folder in our HT docs. I'm going to call it week 4, since we are on week 4. Call it week 4. In this week 4, I'm going to create okay, so in this report, I'm going to name my init.php, but like I told you, my init is like my blackboard. So anytime I do other example, I will delete my init. But you, if you want to keep, if you want to keep records for reference sake, you name your file the example we are working on. So I'm going to zoom so that you can see the code clearly. Okay, so in the class, you know we start PHP with the PHP this. Now, class starts with the keyword class. So class, then you give the class a name. So like we said, the first letter is supposed to be capital letter, even though you can choose to write them in lowercase, but it's advisable that classes first letter begins with the capital letter. Then you declare the variables for that class. So here for students, you can have public ln, which will be for first name. You can have public ln. Okay, the first one is ln for first name, ln for last name. Have public student ID. You can add other ones, but because it's not advisable I do anything for you. So you can add phone, you can add address, you can add as many information as you want. Okay. So these are the class variables which will store the information on the memory for that class. When we create any object, we pass those values in the constructor. So we write a constructor for it. So we have a constructor. We have said the constructor is also a function. So public function. The constructor begins with two underscore. Then construct. Once you write the constructor, it turns to blue. Then the variables that you want to initialize. Now, if they have different, if you decide to use different variable names, in order for you not to use a list, then that one's up to you. So for the first one, I'm going to use first name just to demonstrate something to you. But the rest, I'm going to use the same name as my class variable names. Okay. Now I need to initialize, so I'll use this value to initialize the class variables that I have. So this will initialize this one, then this one will initialize this one, and that one will initialize that one. So if the name for this one is different from the name of that one of the constructor, then that one I don't need the list. But if they are the same, I need the list keyword to differentiate that of the class and that of the constructor. So for ln and the listen, they are the same. So I have to use this ln is equal to $ln. Okay. Remember, when you are using this, the dollar cancel once. So the this, then dash, then arrow, then the name of your variable without the dollar. So that of the student ID to meet with this student ID is equal to student ID. If we have decided to use fn here, then here is going to be this fn, then f is equal to fn. Okay. So now, once you've created a constructor for your class, you can create methods for your class. So you can create set and get methods, as well as you can also create other methods. So I'm going to create set and get method, then I'll write the outcome for the greet or welcome, however you want to write it. So we have public function set fn. So this one takes the first name and set the class first name variable. So fn is equal to fn. So this one will set the class first name variable. Then you use the pop variable. Get method that will return what we set on the menu. So I'm going to return this fn. Okay. So I'm going to copy this and paste and change it to ln to be easy. That of the ln we set ln the last name. That of the student ID. So set student ID. If it's student ID, set the student ID. And now get student ID. Oh, sorry, get that doesn't have any ID. So the sets that we need to pass in argument. So all the gets we can pass in the windows. All the gets we don't pass in it. It gets within the run. So within the stream. Okay. Now we write our welcome function. So public function. However you call it. So this one, if you want to write HTML in our PHP, then you can close our PHP tab. And remember, I read this one, so before I separated them, I close and I open a new one to close the curly bracket. I can write my HTML code inside. So I have the name of the person, then command welcome to advanced web program or web development. So I can write a code. Now, in the class, anytime you are using either a variable or a method in the same class, you need to use this keyword, and that you get an error. Okay, so let me demonstrate it to you so you see what I'm talking about. So if I just write echo fn, okay, then echo ln, okay, right, welcome to web development. Okay. Now, this FN and LN is ambiguous because the class doesn't know if it's referring to the FN, the variable FN we have for the class. That's why you need to qualify to the this keyword. If you don't do that, it will complain. Okay. Now, I will move on to creating objects of the class. If you have a class, how will you create an object before you use the class? So, with that object, you can't use your class. So when you have your class, you need to create objects of the class. So, before you can call the methods you have in that class. So, how do you create objects of the class? So, I can see it as well, but it's also in the notes. So, it says that, write the object name. So, most often the object name, you normally use the lowercase of the first letter, you use the lowercase of the class name. So here our class name is student, so I can decide, by you decide any name you want, but like I've been advising you, you need to write plain and code. So the name of your object should also have something in connection with the name of the class. So I can name the small s, so student, that's my object name. It says write the object name first, then equal to, then you use a new keyword to tell your PHP environment that you are creating an object. So you have the object name which I've given it to the students. Like I advise you, the object name should be similar to your class name so that if someone is reading your code, it knows what it's about. So we have the object name which is student, it's called new. In the class name, here our class name is student. Okay. Now, if your class takes in a constructor input, you put the input here. If it doesn't take any inputs, then you just use an empty bracket. Okay. So here it takes an input, constructor input, which takes our constructor takes first name, last name, and student ID. So I'm going to call. I'm going to pass in those inputs. They are string values. Okay, so I'm going to pass in those values. So my first name is Godwin, last name is Ashon, student ID can be ABD10031456. Okay, so that's my object. I've created my object. Now, to call a method on the object, you call a method, it's just the object name, you create an object name, then dash, then greater than. So, you add this to the object, then once you add it, you can call any of the method in that class. So, I'm going to call the welcome method that we have on that object, in the class, we have it in the class, so I can call it on the object. Now, the welcome doesn't have any input, so I don't have to pass anything here. So I have student, then dash, greater than, then the name of your object. So remember, when you are calling method on objects, it's just the object name, dash, greater than, then the name of the object, if you're, the name of your method. If your method will ask to be, you need to pass in some values, then you need to passing those values. So this one will echo the first name and the last name. Then welcome to web development. Now, if I want to change the name, the first name and the last name on the object variable, then I need to call the set method. So I can call student and set fn. Okay, so in my fn, I can call it the user. Comma, pass name, set element. So set element, you can call it Google. Okay. Now, this will override my previous name value, which is Godwin. So, it will override it to replace what I have in there. So, the constructor initialized on the memory in the variable name. FN, this will be in that memory. The variable name LN, this will be in that member. The variable name student ID, this will be inside. Now, if I call the set, we read the code that it will replace, it will initialize our LN. So this one will replace the value which we stored on our LN on the memory. This one will be FN, and this one will replace that one we have on the LN. So now if I call the student, then welcome, at that point, the welcome function is being called. The values of my first name and my last name has changed. So it will no longer, so this first welcome, at that point, my first name is Godwin. My last name is Ashon. So it's going to write Godwin Ashon, welcome to web development. Now when I call this set function, it will place those FN and the LN values. So it will be Joseph Kobo, welcome to web development. Like I told you, it's going to give us an error here because we didn't qualify that this variable is relating to the class. So when you are calling a method or a variable in the class, you need to qualify it with this so that it knows which method you are calling or which variable you are calling, whether it's relating to that class that you are inside. Okay. So if I run this, so I'm going to, let's see if I've started my example. Okay, I've started my example. So I can run this. Carlos. So the encoder name we'll see the X from that script. Okay. So as I told you, you are getting undefined FN, undefined LN, undefined FN, because when you call the welcome method, in that function, the FN and the LN were not defined. Okay. So anytime you are using a method in a class, or you are using a variable of that class in another method, you need to qualify them with these keywords so that it knows that they are referring to that of the class. So here, you need to qualify it with this. Okay. You need to qualify it with this. Okay. Then you can also call the get FN method, which will also retain the value you set for this variable as well. They all do the same thing. So if I write another function here, I'll call this time, I'll call it great. Then, okay. So here, I'm going to call the method get FN. So like I told you, even if you are calling the method in that class, you need the this keyword. Okay. So get FN. Okay. Then this one too. I want to call the method. So get FN. So in that case, I also set another information. This time I will do it. So let's say for example we have okay. And here I'm going to come and do it. So this one will also override our previous name. So then now I'll be deleted. So when we call the grids, then it will call the read function. So the read function calls our get FN, which retains the value we set in our the variable memory for our variable. And this one retains the value we set for our variable. So when you run this code, that's what you have. Okay. So you can see your action. Then this one, why is it not retaining the last name that we have? please. Means you still need at least you do it, but so it's not storing it in the memory of the objects, so you still need it for. So all the places, even in the constructor, all the places that should be using the variable names in the class, you need to write this, the this, then arrow, the dash, then arrow, then the variable name. Anytime you are referring to any of these variables in any method in that class. So we continue. So since I've done most of the coding, so you can add different fields like getting the address of the student, the phone of the student, the program of the student. So you can add those fields and also display them. So in the display, can also display other information like the student ID. So you can write this student ID. Okay. Then you start to use the script. So therefore the student objects then dash then greater than then student ID, you use the get student ID to retain the ID which value reset is what is being displayed. So add other fields and display them. Okay. So you do that before you check the subsequent code. So you move on. So I've explained all this. So you create an employee class as is being stated here. So you do that before you check the code. So you create an employee class. So the class name is supposed to be employee. You capture you like a bright suit. Then you initialize the values of the first name, the last name, date of birth, ID of the employee, the salary of the employee. Then you get all those values using the gets. Now, if you want to update the values, you can also use the set method to update the values. So once you have done, then you check the code. Okay. So this one, the class variable names, and this is the constructor. So you pass in those variable names, then you initialize them. So you have this, then that, then that, then that. Then you initialize your constructor, then you have our get methods which retains the face of the menu names. Okay. So you try to do that before you try before you refer to the code you have on the page on the new content. So do it on your own. Click objects, display the first name, the last name, date of birth, ID that you've gotten when you created the object, you display all of them. Then if you need to have a welcome, you can also include the welcome. Like I explained, the objects, the most popular name should be just the class name. Slowakis starting it. Then if the class has a constructor, you pass in the necessary input. If it doesn't, it's going to be empty brackets. Okay, so this is an example of how you can call the AE class. Calling method, the name of the object dash greater than. Then the name of the method, if the method takes in inputs, it just passes the appropriate inputs. Okay. So this is a complete code. So write your code first before you verify, before you check what you have over here. Now, if your class is in a different file, then you need to include that file in your code where you are creating the object of your class. So if the file is directly in the same folder where you have the object, then you just write include, then the path of your PHP script for your class. But if it is in a folder, then include in the folder name, then slash. If there are more folders, you go slash that folder names until you get to the path where the file is. Okay. Now, as you can see, when you open, you can see the path over here. So here, the index is in week 4. If there is another folder and I have a file there, it goes with slash, the folder name slash the file. So you make sure you write the file name the way, the path of your file for your class. So for example, if our employee class is in the folder called classes, then we have to include it as classes slash employee.php. Now in our subsequent weeks, which we also do it now, classes that we create, it is advisable you put them in the folder called classes. Because in our future project that we'll be creating, this is the format or the structure of our project. All class files, we are going to save them in our classes folder. So when we are including in the file that we will be calling those, we'll be creating an object for the class, it's going to be include the classes slash employee, classes slash the class file. Okay, so that is it. Okay. So in this example, where we have the student, let's copy. Okay. So let's copy the student class. Okay. So I'm going to create a folder here. Okay, first let's put the student class in the same folder as our class where we are creating the object. So that's first the have our class name. Our class file is .php. Okay, so we have our. Okay, so since it is in the same folder as our where we have the object, we just include it student.php. Fresh. So this file has our class. So it will just include our class. So when you create the object, you see it. But if your path name, your class path name is incorrect, you get an error. For example, if I write classes slash student.php, classes slash student.php, it will tell me that file is not found because in the classes, you don't have classes slash student.php. So you get the error craft God opens windows and power directly. Okay. So now I'll close my student PhD. And I'm going to create in the folder, I'm going to create the classes folder. Classes. Now classes folder. So in this classes folder, I'm going to put this student class inside. Okay. So I'm going to put this one in classes folder. So now that is the path of my student.php file, which contains the student class. So I have classes slash student. Okay. So if you go to the folder classes, you are supposed to see a file for student.php which contains the class, my student's class. So if I run this, well, now that the file is there, it contains a class, you know, it disappears. Okay, so you continue. You continue with inheritance. So what is inheritance? In the layman language, inheritance is acquiring something from a person. So, ideally, normally we inherit from our parents. So, we inherit the looks, the properties, or anything. So, that's inheritance. So, in programming tools, we have inheritance where the subclass inherits the property of their parents. So, all the methods that their parents have, they can have access to them. Now we use a keyword extends. We use a keyword extends to inherit the property of the parent. So to write an inheritance or an extension of a class, one class from the other, is just the class name. So class, the class name. Then we use a keyword extends. Then the name of the class you are extending your property. So we are going to create a class we are going to call person. In our classes folder, we are going to be a person, and this person will have the variable will be fn ln, which is first name, last name, date of birth, phone and address. Okay, so that will be the person. So this person will create another class which will extend our person class, which will be for students. So in the students, they have all these properties, so we can extend our person class and just add some few features to it so that we can have a new class for students. Then for your own assignment, you also extend the person class. You create an employee class also in it. Okay, so I'm going to create my person class. So we are going to save it in hands. So classes, we have person.php. Okay. So now since we've written that of the students, in order for us to, I'll just copy what we've done already. And I'll just change the name of the class. Okay. And it has address. So that we have student ID using this and a date of birth and phone. So date of birth. Now, since we know that we have already explained this one, let's make all of them the same as our class grab. So, yes, FNFN. So, after LN, we have same as our date of birth. Okay, so now we have that on. So this will initialize all our values. Now, if you want, you can also have a setting. So here we have set phone, which takes in the phone. Set the values. Here we have phone. So that is our person class. So a person has first name, last name. Person has first name, last name. Then date of birth, phone, and address. So we set all of them. Then if you want to have set methods, you can have the set methods on them. Then you can have their corresponding gets. Now we go to the extent. So we are going to create. So we will create a student class which will inherit the person class. Then we'll add some few methods. So in the student class, we will need to add student ID and the program the student is reading. So later on, if you want additional features, then you can also add those ones that you need. So we have our class students, then we are going to extend our person class, then we have our this and this are unique for the student. It's not in our parent class, which is the person, so we just declare those variable names. Then in our constructor, we pass both the values for our parent class and that of the additional value for our new class. So the ones for our parent class, we are going to use it to set the parent constructor. So the parent constructor, you start with this keyword parent, then you have two column, then two underscore, the constructs. So you just pass in the values, the constructor values for your parents over here. So now once you do that, this will set the values of the class variable for your parent class. Now you can continue with that of the class, the student class, which has this unique variable names, which you are setting now. So you have them over here. Then you can create, you can use the methods we have already on the parent, so you don't need to create them. But the methods you don't have, for example, you don't have the set ID and get ID and set program and get program. So we'll add those two methods. Okay, so let's get started. So, okay, so you can either delete the previous student class that you wrote in the classes, or you can just open it and do the modification. Okay. So with this one, then here now we are extending, so extends. Okay. Now if you are extending, you need to include that class. So since it's in the same folder, you just include it by the name. So we have person. Because it's in the same folder, so the person and the students are in the same folder, so just the file name, then it extends. So here, so I can let me delete. So now we have class students, it's extending that of the person, and it's the only difference of the variable it doesn't have is the ID, so public ID, then public and program. Okay. Now we have a constructor for our lesson. So we have public function and two underscore then construct. Okay. So it takes the same argument our parent takes with addition of some few arguments. And just copy this one we have for our parent. Okay. So all these variables, we need to declare them. Okay, so this one will be the, that's, so this one should be for our parents, which we will pass them when we call our class, the student class, we pass the first name, the last name, date of birth, phone, and address, which we use to set our parent class. But for the student class, we also need the ID, the program. Okay. So that will be for the constructor. Okay. Now to set that of the parent, you use the keyword parent. Okay. Then two columns. Then you write the underscore for the construct. So you can copy that of the parent. Okay. So the first name you have for your student construct, you use it to set the parent's first name. The last name you use to set the parent last name. The date of birth you use to set the parent date of birth. The phone we use to set the parent phone. The address we use to set the parent address. Now for the ID in the program, which is unique for the student. Now here we need to set it. So this ID equal to ID. Then this program equal to program. Okay. Now we need to create set and get methods for our ID and our program. So we have public function set ID. We paste an ID. Then this ID is equal to ID. Okay. And then get to public function get ID. Get, we don't have any arguments, so that one is just return the value. So return this ID. Okay. We have that of the program. So public function set program. We take the program from the set. This program. Get public function get program. Return this program. Okay. Now we are done with Now we are done with the student class, so we can call our student class in our index.php like we did. So we included the file for the student class. Then you pass in the necessary input values. So the first one is first name. So first name. And the second one is last name. So that is last name. And the third one is date of birth. So that's, you have date of birth here. The fourth one is phone. So we have phone. And after phone, we have address. You set the address. Then we have that of the ID, student ID. Then we have the program the student is reading. Okay. So this creates the student object. So once you've created a student object, you can call any of the methods on the student objects. So for example, if we want to greet so first of all we can display our first name and our last name. I remember the first name and the last names are names which are on the our parent class. So first name. So since you've inherited that method, you can just call it get hyphen, which returns the first name. Okay. Then you can have that of last name. Which will return that of the last name. Remember, all these methods are that which are in the parent. Okay. So you can add the other information. This phone is also on the parent. This one is the one in the student class that we wrote, the new method that we wrote. Then you can also call the new method, which is the program, get program that we wrote. Okay. You can also set those values and show them on the page. So you just play with them by just calling the parent method in the objects that you've created for the student. So the student object that you created, you can call both a method in the parent, both the parent and the student class itself. So you can call any of these methods, or you can call any of the methods in the parent as well, and see how it's being used. Okay, so that's about the inheritance. So inheritance allows you to have the methods of your parents class that you extend. Okay, then if your parent has a constructor, then you need to take your constructor values then you set them in the parent keyword. So parent, then two column, then two underscore, then construct. Then that one will be that of the parent constructors. So you to set them. Then the additional one for the new class, you just write them to set them. Then you can write additional method for the new class that you want. Then in your object that you create for the new class, you can call any of the methods. You can call a method in the parent, you can call the method in the actual class as well. Okay, so we continue. So as you can see, we have get program, get ID. These are the new parts that we create in the new student. This one is in the parent class. That one is in the parent class. So it doesn't matter whether both parents or the subclass or the class that inherited, you can get all those methods from them. Okay. So you do that for the assignment, you do that for employee. So create a class called employee and extend a person class from it. So the employee, you have additional field like the salary for the employee, the one the salary takes, then display the salary as well. Any other additional feature that the employee can have, you can add it to it. That's your personal project. So if you have any challenge, you just contact me, then I'll try to see why you are getting those error points. You need to practice. So I do later, you do more. You practice and get familiarized with what we are doing. So now we come to encapsulation. So encapsulation is just protecting some of the methods and the variables you have. So if you have public, then it means it can be accessed anywhere in your projects. So wherever you access that variable, if you declare a variable public, it can be accessed anywhere, whether in the class, outside the class, or anywhere that class, that variable or method can be accessed. But for protected, you can only access them in the class itself and the class which inherited them. The classes which inherited and the class itself can get those variables which you declare as protected, or which you declare as a method which you declare as protected as well. So you can get them within the class and outside the class from a class which inherited that parent class. But for private, you can only use it within the class. Even you can use it in classes which inherited that class. Only within that class. Outside it, you get an error. Now, if you have an object, if you have an object in the class, maybe a class data variable is also another object, then to access the method of that object, it is then the object name, or the object name in the class, then the method on the object. So normally in your constructor of the main class, you create the objects and you pass it in the constructor. Then you initialize that object variable in the class with the value, the object you pass in the constructor. So to demonstrate it, I've written some handy codes that we'll be using in our project in our subsequent weeks. So you can create a folder called classes where you put in this code. So we have a function called functions. So a class called functions. So in this class, we put functions that are not database related. So in this class, we put it in the file called fn.php. So all functions which are not database related, we'll be writing them in our fn, in our subsequent weeks. That's what we'll be doing. So these functions will be handy for you in our subsequent weeks. So you can just copy and paste the code. And paste the code in our fn function. Okay. So you can just copy it. So you create a file called fn. So in that, it jumped the test. I need to copy this. Okay. Okay, so you just copy this quotes. So you create a new class in our classes folder. So all in our subsequent weeks, all our classes that we create, we put them in the folder called classes. Okay, so you create fn.php. can put our code inside. Okay. So I will explain this code in our subsequent weeks when we need them. But in this example, in our subsequent example, I'm going to explain the validation of dates, validate dates, and encryption of passwords. So that is the one that those two functions that I'm going to explain. But in the subsequent ones, when we need them, I will just call your mind to that function. So in the validate dates, if this function takes in the day and the day of the month and the year, then check if that date is valid. If it takes, it returns true. If not, it returns false. Then the other one, which is encrypt password, okay. Then the encrypt password will encrypt your test. So this one will encrypt any test that is being passed. It encrypts it in MD5. So if a password is entered, it will encrypt it, so you don't see the plain text. So when we are storing password on a database, we are going to encrypt it with this function, so that when somebody is even viewing what is on the database, the person will not see the plain text. Okay. So that is what basically I will explain to you. The subsequent ones, we will talk about them when we need them, and I'll draw your attention to them. Okay. So remember this function class. Now, if I tell you that we need that class, then you need to create the folder for classes. Then you can either go and copy it and paste this function, then you can use the function as well. Then you also have the database function. So any functions which doesn't have any, it's not connected to the database, we are going to write it in our function class. So the function class, like I said, it is in the fn php file. All our database related functions, we are going to write them in our database, in our database class. So in the database class, you save the file as db.php. So you have a new file called db, the same classes folder. You have db.php. Then in that class, you have this code. Okay, so you have this code. So all database related functions, you'll be writing them over here. Okay. So here we created, like I wanted to draw your attention. We created the objects for our function class. So in this constructor, whenever we create a database function, we are going to pass the function object, the object for the function class over here. So it's going to initialize this function object variable. So it's going to initialize it so that we can have all the methods of that function class. Because in some of our database functions, we'll make use of the functions which has been written in our function class. Okay, for example, when we are authenticating a user, because we encrypted the password, we also need to encrypt the plain text the user will enter. So we need this encrypt password in our database function. So we needed this object to as our data variable. So we create the object, then you pass it to your constructor class when you are creating your database object. Now when you are calling the method in the object, like I explained to you, you use this. So for example, the session is a method in the function class. So you have this function class, we are called session. So when we get to the login feature, we'll talk about session. So sessions we use to check who has logged in. So when we come to, so when you are writing an application, it's appropriate for you to write a function which has the name of your session, so that if you are working for another customer, you just change the name, okay, so that you don't need to be hardcoding those tests. So that's the method we've called. And the function class variable, object variable in our class is called fn. Okay, so it's just that this keyword, then the object name, then the method you are calling on that object. Okay, so that's what I want to draw your attention to. So this get client IP is also a method in our function class, which returns the IP address that the person is using to access your website. So that function only works if it's on the server. If you are using it on the exam, it will not work. So in that, you have the get client IP address, which returns the IP address of the one browsing your site. Okay. So that is it. That's this point. So you should create a file db.php and when paste this code there. Then you create a file fn.php and create the function code there. Then subsequent ones, you see how you use those codes just as an example. So like I've explained this. So we have the function class object. Then in the constructor, we pass in the function class object. Then we initialize this one by that object so that it will have all the properties, all the methods in the objects we initialize it with. Now, if you are assessing the method on the object, it's this keyword, then the object name. So in our case, our object name was fn. Then the method you are assessing. So if the method you are assessing is, for example, session, then it's supposed to be this fn, then session comes over here. Then if your method doesn't have any input, just bracket. If it has, then you pass in the appropriate input. Okay, so this is just an example. So when we get to login feature, you see this. So this one calls the name of the function, which we put, the name of our session, which we put in this function. So this is a function class object, which is in our class. So we have this, then we refer to that function class object. Then the method we are calling on that object follows. Okay. So for the object in the class, you have three. You have 1, 2, 3. But for just a variable or a method in the class, it just gives the name of the variable or the name of the method. Talk about this. Okay. So another example can be seen in the local database class. So we have update user set. This one we will later on talk about it. So that what we want to address is the get client IP address. Get client IP. So get client IP is a method in the function class. So to call that method, you need the this keyword, then your function class object name, then you can call the method on it right here. Okay, so we continue. Okay. Now if you are writing a project and you have more classes, then it's appropriate for you to have one init file where you listed all your classes in it. So if you need a class, you don't need to be including all the classes on your files, PHP files that need the classes. You only include the index.php file, which contains all the list of the classes you have on your folder. So in the classes folder that we have, you create an init file where we will include our classes in that folder. So for example, we can create a file for init where we have these classes. We have fn.php and db.php. So we create, and this one should put, supposed to be in the same folder where your file, where you make reference of the classes. So in this example, in our index.php, this example, where we have, we'll be referring to our class, we can create a new file. We have, can call it init.php. Okay, so in this init.php has already included the fn and the db files. Okay, so if we need it, we only include the init.php. which has all those functions. So we just include init dot php over here. Okay. So this one will include all our classes. So this one includes all our classes. So you can create objects of all the two classes. Since when we include the init.php, the init.php has those two classes, so it will also be automatically included in this file, in the index.php file. So we can create objects of those two classes. Okay. So like I explained to you, that all our database related functions, we put them in our db.php, and our regular functions, which is not database related, we put them in our fm.php. So by now you should be able to have a file called db.php and fm.php in our classes folder. So in it, we also have init.php, which contains their path. And the init.php is supposed to be the same file, at the same folder where the file where you calling those, creating the objects and use those classes are. So this is a demo which for you, if you are not using the index and you are not wiping your index code and you want to create a different file for the demonstration, you can call it demo. So in this example, we include our init.php, which has already included our path to our classes. Then we create objects for our function class. Like I told you, the database class requires the object of our function class, so that we'll be able to call some of the function, the methods we have in this class. So it passes those, the objects over there. So first, you create an object of your function class before you create the object of your database class, because you need a function class object to pass as a constructor over here. Okay, so once you've done that, then you can now here we call our encrypt password method, which is in our function object class. So we call the object name and dash then arrow, then the method name is encrypt password. Then we are encrypting this password through chat, so you can put in a test there. Then you can see that the test will be encrypted to a different test, that no one will see this was the test that was encrypted to that. Okay. Then we will also call the validate method. So we have the fn validate date. So this one, it takes in the day, the month, and the year. And if it's okay, it will say it. If not, it will say it's invalid. So for example, for February, we don't have 31. So when you run this code, you're supposed to get date is invalid. Okay. So remember, in the validate date, it returns true or false. So we check if it is true, then we output this. If it is not true, then we output this. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to copy and paste this in index.php and run so that you can see the outcome. This is right. Okay. So init.php. Remember, where your init should be the same file where you are including, you are writing your objects for those classes. Your init is supposed to be the same folder. If not that, it will even tell you that it cannot find the file. So the init is supposed to be the same. So this one will include your all the classes you have. So all the classes you have, you write their path in the init.php. Then you just include the init.php in the places where you need in order for you to create the objects. So then you create the object. So
This object for the function class. This object for the database. Okay. Now we call this method on the object class. So the method is encrypt password. So here we are encrypting QChat. Okay. So you can put any other test and change them several times, and you can see the effect. Then we have the day, month, and year we've set. So we validate our date and see if it is correct or not. So I'm going to run this code. So as you can see, we have encrypt password, QChat. So this is an encrypted password. Then validate, you say date is invalid because you don't have 31st of February. So I can change this date to maybe 25th. Okay, 25th. Now I can change the password test, maybe test. I run this. Okay. So now you can see that the date is okay. The password. This is the encrypted password. So if you are seeing this on the database, you now know that it's when the person is logging in, the person will use test as a password because you cannot figure it out. That's why we encrypt the password. So in our project, in our subsequent week, next week we'll be learning database. So in our database, when we are writing our scripts, we are going to encrypt all the password tests to an encrypted test so that if somebody even see the database, do not know what the passwords are. So that's what we will do. So make sure this fn and the db and the appropriate folders, the classes folder, because in our subsequent weeks we'll be using them and calling some of the functions. A function which we don't have, we will add it to it. So make it a very handy. That's why I call it handy classes. So you make it easily accessible by you. So anytime I refer to those files, you know that they are over here. So you can just copy it in the appropriate folders. We can add a new method that we need. Okay. So but these are the explanations which I've explained already. Then we conclude with special methods. So special methods, like we've seen, one is the underscore underscore construct, which creates initialize your data variables. Okay. Then we also have one which is underscore underscore describes. It describes whenever it's like the object or the variables has finished being used, then the describe will be called to automatically delete them so that it will free space on the memory. Then also in the database connection, if you don't use the database anymore, the describe will also be called so that you free the database connection to free the resources as well. Okay. So that is it for today. So I'll briefly go to the class and basic structure, then I'll revise. So I'll start with narrating the class. So this week, make sure you have an employee class, which is an extension of a person class. So that's your assignment you need to work on. So when we are indexing from another class, we use a key extends. And once you write the methods for your parents and the class itself, you will be able to access the method both in the class itself and its parent class. So in this example, you saw that you can see the keyword extends. So the student's class extends from the person class. So you need to write the person class and you need to include that file so that that class will be available in your current file that you are extending the mother class or parent class. Okay. And that's the parent class, right? Okay. The parent class, you said you first of all have your variables. Okay. So you can declare your variables, all of them as public at once, or you can declare them one by one and public them name variable, public, then the name variable. So however it is, but you can just write one qualifier for all of them at once. Then we have the constructor. We said the constructor is also a function. So you just start with public function, then two underscore, then construct, then you pass in the data variable you want to initialize your class variables with. Now if the variable name is the same as the other one, you use this. But like I've explained, that if you are using a variable name, if you are using a method in the class, always qualify them with the this. So any variable which is in the class which you are referring to, you qualify them with this. Any method you are using a class, you are calling, when you are invoking the method in that class, you also use this for that. Other than that, it will tell you that it is undefined, because it will not know which one we are talking about. Now if you are using a class, you need to include it. If the class is in a different file, you need to include that file in your project. So you call the function called include, then you indicate the path of your class. So once you indicate the path of your class, if the path is not found, you get an error that the path cannot be found. As far as the path is there, then you can fit object your class. So if your class is in a folder, then the folder name slash the name of your file. If it's not, then the file name over there. So I think basically that's it. So your project and class, and extend it from the person class. This class should have other features aside the ones that we have, like salary, and other features like a country and so on, and maybe the department of the employee and so on. Okay, so thank you very much. So if you have any challenge, you know where to contact me. Just log in and click on chat with an instructor, and you can send me a screenshot of the place where you are having a challenge. Then you remember that CoolChat is being supported by voluntary donation. So once you are enjoying the features of the site, try to also bring your friends over here so that the site can also create enough traffic, and as well as if it's in your power to donate, when you click on the donate button, it takes you to the donation page where you can enter the amount you want to donate. So once you've entered it, you can check, you can choose the payment method you want, then you can make donation. So the instructors use these resources to the amount are used to pay the instructors, which instructs you on the site, and also assist people with their homework and your programming errors that you'll be meeting. There are people that will be available for them to check your errors and make corrections or give you suggestions of where you are getting those errors. So remember to support the platform as well. Okay, but have a lovely day, and it was nice topic we had today. Class is very important, because in our subsequent weeks, we'll be using class a lot. So when we are coding, we want to start with the object oriented from the beginning, so that when you start developing our application, it will be easy for you to do those applications. Okay, so have a lovely day. Enjoy the rest of the day. Bye.